Are you sick of DJs who get paid to get songs played off a set list that exists in the money-filled fists of the fat cat? That's old hat. You don't need that. Let's bring back the good tracks with the real cats who you knew you and blew you away with the way they could say what they wanted to say every day. Let's bring back the good old days when cruising with the tunes in the afternoons was in and human beings were human beings who loved the simple things, not being rough, tough, or rich enough to buy all that stuff. When people drove with their windows open and listened to music and had good times rolling, and they loved singing with the radio.
Singing with the radio.
Let's bring that back. Ramapo 90.3 on the FM dial. While streaming online, you'll find WRPR is by the people for the people. And let's bring back singing with the radio.
Singing with the radio.
I'm a champion. Realize Shaq's mechanism. Yah, 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 yah.
Alright, Shaquille O'Neal for rap. This is not your normal PSA. Don't be stupid. Don't drink and drive. If you're gonna go out and have a good time, it's fine. But designate a driver to drive home. Let's stop the madness. Don't drink and drive.
A public service announcement brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
You're listening to WRPR Mawa.
Now that's a face for radio.
You are now listening to Beasts of the East with Ryan Morick, Scott Thompson, and Dean Roventini on WRPR 90.3 FM.
Hello, fans of all ages. We are indeed the Beats of the East. Ryan Morick, Scott Thompson, Dean Roventini, right here with you, coming to you live from Studio A here at Ramapo College of New Jersey in Mahwah, New Jersey, on this Monday, September 19th, 2016. I'm back in the States. Woo. The Jets are 1-1. Giants are 2-0.
Ha!
Your headphones don't work either, do they?
I don't know
what
happened.
They work a little bit.
I don't know what happened.
I don't.
I'm sad.
Mine's never worked.
How about now? Can you hear me now? Remember
those commercials? Oh, that's better. You should have to turn it up.
Yeah.
That guy's back. Ever see that?
Remember those commercials? Can you hear me now?
He's back.
Yeah, he's with Sprint now.
He does Sprint.
It's been with Sprint, I thought.
No, it was always with Verizon.
Really?
Verizon was, can you hear me now? Can you hear me now?
When I first saw it, blew my mind.
Yeah.
Remember those, you know those This Is Sports Center commercials, right?
Oh, the best things ever, yeah.
The one with Antonio Brown.
Oh, the receptionist.
I just love how he answers the phone.
That's called a phone call, does?
Hello, ESPN. First of all, Antonio speaking.
Does he call himself the call god? Because...
What do you mean?
Like, after all of his tweets and Instagram posts, he puts hashtag call god. Is that his nickname?
I guess.
Or is that... Like, I've never heard anyone call him that. But then after I talked to him, I was like, you know, let me give him a follow on Twitter and Instagram and everything. Hashtag call god. I was like, does he call himself that, or...
I've honestly never heard that.
Oh, I think it's kind of cool. Make, I'm going to start calling myself that. Hashtag call
Dean,
god.
Dean, I don't think he can do that, Dean.
What?
I don't
he's think closed. He can do that. That's what happens when your headphones don't work. You can't talk smack about people.
Yeah. I was a little legit whispering. I don't think you can hear me at all. Yeah.
Oh.
That's the
thing. I can't.
Before our games, we test out our volume, and we just whisper like,
hey.
This weekend.
Yeah. No one can hear us.
I told him that. I told him that.
That you can just talk about people and
no one knows.
It's great.
Yeah.
We don't talk about people. You could. Just figuratively speaking.
Mm-hmm.
No, we do it all the time.
No, but announcement, if you didn't know, Dean is part of the RamapoAthletics.com broadcasting crew now. Finally.
Welcome.
Literally all I had to say was, yeah, you talked to my friend Dean, right? She's like, yeah, I forgot. She goes, I honestly just forgot to email him back. She goes, our boss Rachel, just tell him to come in tomorrow. He can do it.
Welcome.
Thanks.
How'd you do?
It was fun. I don't know.
It is fun.
I think I did all right.
So what did you call? You did volleyball.
Women's volleyball and soccer.
You did women's volleyball and soccer. So you did volleyball Friday, soccer.
No. All one day.
All one day.
What time was the volleyball game on
was
Friday?
Was that
11?
Well,
on Saturday, I meant.
Saturday was at 11, and the soccer game was at 1.
And then you went right to the soccer game.
Mm-hmm. We actually packed up and ran down. Didn't really run, but yeah.
Yeah, I walked.
All right, that's good.
In the big suitcase. That's funny. Yeah, I gotta get myself a polo.
Yeah.
And I think I have to go home and get some polos, too.
I have some. They might be a little big.
Yeah, Dean came.
What size are you? A large? I have a couple larges that you can rock.
No, yeah. Dean honestly came completely dressed up, and I felt so underdressed. I felt bad.
Well, like, I don't know. Just, I did like the pants. Like, I don't want to show up in shorts. Like, I don't know what to expect.
He was, I wear.
Rachel usually tells us if it, like, if we're outside, be comfortable.
Yeah. Like
if it's 90 for degrees
baseball,
outside,
baseball in like the beginning when it's March, like we wore layers on layers.
Oh, we wear full on hoodies and stuff. Let's get right into it, though. We just talked about nonsense for the last 3.5 minutes. But the Giants are 2-0. They will be facing the 1-1 Redskins on Thursday. The matchup we're all waiting for, Odell versus Josh Norman, round two. We'll get into that soon. But first, I want to talk about the Giants. And we can basically say the same thing for this week and last week. Last week and this week are both games that last year they probably would have lost. Last week and this week, running game was pretty good. Defense played phenomenally. Offense, again, not relying on Odell. We were talking about this last night. Back-to-back games where Odell really isn't the MVP of the wide receiver trio. And Sterling Shepard led the team in receiving yards. And yeah, Odell had 8 catches. He could have, he should have had 9 or 10. 9 with the dropped easy touchdown and 10 with the one in the back of the end zone on that fourth down. Great play by Sterling Moore, though. Mm-hmm. But Shepard and Victor Cruz are both having... If you told me 3 months ago that Victor Cruz would have the game-winning, well, game-saving moments in each of the last 2 weeks, there's no way I would have believed you. And mm-hmm. we were talking last night. The fact that they trust Sterling Shepard with lob balls already, and the fact that they trust Victor Cruz with lob balls already, and we see both of them move around the field, that is a very good sign for the Giants, even if Odell Beckham is not at his best yet, which he hasn't been the last couple of weeks.
Yeah, I absolutely love it. Ryan, you bring up a great point that you said they trust Sterling Shepard when they need him, when they need him to make a score, if they need him to make a first down on third or fourth down. And I think it's well-deserved. I think he could have debatably gone first round. He could have been up there with Laquon Treadwell and Josh Doctson. But instead, he went in the second round, and he's already making a giant impact for this team. Like you said, over 100 yards yesterday receiving, leading the team. It's only week 2. Imagine what he can do week 14, week 15, when the Giants may actually need him to secure a game. But I just love how, overall, Eli Manning is just utilizing all of his assets. We see it in the backfield throwing screens to Shane Vereen. Shane Vereen had a stretch where he was just running up and down the field to get them into the red zone. Unfortunately, though, the team had a couple of fumbles. They had a few mishaps. And even with all this stuff that we're talking about, they actually haven't hit their stride.
No.
The offense has not even hit their stride where they can be at their best, at their most dangerous. And they're still 2-0, which is absolutely amazing.
I'm enjoying watching this team right now because, like you said, they're spreading the wealth around. And I love how they're just kind of just going right into it with Shepard and even Victor Cruz. Obviously, Victor Cruz hasn't played for a long time, but he's getting those tough plays. Shepard's getting lob passes. You know what I mean? So I like that coming from the Giants. I think their play calling all throughout the game has been very good.
Very good play.
Last year, I feel like it was like, what are you doing? You should be doing this, blah, blah. But now it's like you sit back and...
Very good
play. Except for that run on first and 30, but I mean...
Well, but again... Last year it was, you know, 10 calls. We could have said, exactly. You should have done something else. Right. Just one call is what you think of.
No football team is perfect, but it's a lot better from last year. I like what the backfield's doing. Even Jennings is looking a lot better from last year.
Did you guys see the stat that they put up in the beginning of the game? Rashad Jennings has the most rushing yards by any running back since week 14 of last year.
Mm-hmm.
Is that real?
Yes.
I didn't see that.
He really solidified himself last year, and he said, listen.
Yeah, when they finally named their starting running back in week 14 last year.
And it helped him. It boosted his confidence in the offseason. I think he put on some extra muscle that he didn't need it. But
God was a tank before that.
Yeah, put on some more muscle. You could see that he's not trying to run himself through holes anymore. He's shifty. He's looking before he runs, putting his hand on his blockers and making sure that he's surveying the entire field before he takes that first step. He's doing a very good job of opening up the offense, too, because when you get those 5-6-yard runs, it helps your team as well. You can have Eli Manning sit back and say, all right, I got only 4 yards for a first down, and you just chug away and chug away. Fortunately, yesterday you have, you know, Victor Cruz not really paying attention, but that's just stuff you got to tweak up.
Mm-hmm.
And you're going to need to because, again, you have a good division opponent who needs a win coming at you this Sunday, and then you got to go to Minnesota and Green Bay. So tweak these things up. Hopefully the Giants can hit their stride, but I'm loving the way the offense is looking at the moment.
We're talking New York Giants right here on Beast of the East on WRPR 90.3 FM. Call in with your thoughts if you so please. 201-825-1234 is the number. That's 201-825-1234. If I had to ask you guys this question, I'm going to ask you this question.
I was about to say, just
yeah. What percentage of plays do you think that Odell, Sterling Shepard, and Victor Cruz, what do you think the percentage is of all three of them on this field together from yesterday's game?
What do you mean?
Do you know it? Are you?
I know the answer.
How many percentage-wise snaps did they play?
Percentage-wise, what percent of snaps were they on the field?
It seemed like a lot. I would say 90.
94%.
Wow.
And 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, the question was, is Victor Cruz going to make this team?
Yes. You're right. I didn't think they would.
Go ahead.
No, I was just. I'm saying like nine. It seems like right because it seems like at all game yesterday, that they were. It didn't seem like none of them were sitting or you know. It's just like I don't know. I'm like shocked by it.
You're saying all three of them at the same time
yes.
on the field, right?
Yeah. Yes.
But it makes absolute sense because when you are spreading the wealth, when you're not just focusing on Odell Beckham Jr. like they were last year, if you're not just focusing on you know one person. They don't get as tired.
Yeah.
And the offense is just rolling. They don't have to do anything. It's just methodical. This is what you do in the preseason. Those first two games, Odell didn't play. You know, Cruz sat out. And it looked like it was just Shepard trying to get his reps. But as they started getting into everything, you know, you saw the team starting to become a unit. And that's why I think that right now they are a team on everyone's list that is very surprising because they made such a shift. And we're not even talking about the defense yet. We're talking about this offense
yeah.
and how last year it was deadly. Now you have two actual other receivers that are deadly as well. You know, it's not just Odell Beckham that, okay, you know where the ball's going to on third down. You have no clue where that ball's going to on third down. You could have it drop down into a screen to Shane Vereen. You could have Odell going on a long ball. You could have, you know, Sterling Shepard or Cruz in the slot, making an out route. You have no clue what this mm-hmm. offense is going to do, and that's why, Dean, made a very good point. Play calling has been 10 times better, even though Mike Sullivan has a sheet McAdoo's kind of making the call.
That's why you see Eli spread around, because you do all that with those guys. You can mix and match. But going back to what you said, Ryan, like I didn't even think Victor Cruz was going to be able to play as much as he's playing right now.
Yeah.
You don't know. The guy's, you know, it seems like, oh, he's going to – I thought he was going to come back last year. Yep. No, it's been hold off. So, I mean, he's playing. He's coming out with a bang. That run, unfortunately, he fumbled at the end of the run. But that run was awesome. I mean, to start it off, it was amazing.
That's just ball security. That was
– Well, he forgot that a guy was behind him.
Yeah.
Me and Dean were talking about it. Was he just going to stop running?
I mean, yeah, he just figured like, oh, he's gone. Yeah. He's never going to come back.
I got to write one of my last features with Scout was on Victor Cruz and how I basically said his word about, yeah, I'm coming back, I feel good, was, you know, as reliable as a blind surgeon. That's exactly what I wrote. You couldn't take his word for it. He had to show it to you. And these past 2 weeks, he's done even more than that. And it looks like he's back 100% healthy.
Love it.
I said beginning of the year, I said to myself, you have to assume that Victor Cruz is not going to play. I said that.
Until it happens, yeah.
Until it happens, you have to assume he's not on the roster. And you said it. Last year, this offense relied on Eli, Odell, a little bit of Jennings, a little bit of Vereen, and then they tried every running back known to man on their roster, including the practice squad. And then they slowly got Will Tye into the mix once Larry Donnell was out. And they even put Larry Donnell in the mix last year. So their receiving core last year, Odell Beckham Jr., Reuben Randle was their number two, and Dwayne Harris was their three. Now they have Odell Beckham Jr., Sterling Shepard, who has shown a lot of promise, Victor Cruz, who has shown a lot of promise. Rashad Jennings has only gotten better by the week, and the stats prove it, leading rusher since week 14 of last year. Shane Vereen has been a great passing back, 59 catches last year. I didn't know that. He's been phenomenal out of the backfield in the passing game and on third downs. And they're getting Larry Donnell in the mix. They're getting Will Tye in the mix. That's seven legitimate threats.
Both who have hands. There isn't just one blocking tight end and one catching tight end. They can both beat you.
Yeah. Eli loves Donnell, too. There was a couple of play calls, too, when I think they had him.
They had Larry Donnell out wide left, and they hit him on a back post fade.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. That's the exact play I was thinking of. I was like, I mean, Eli's got to be having the time of his life right now.
No, exactly. And
that's
why he
has seven people that he can legitimately trust as long as he has the time to do so.
That's why I love this offense right now, especially the age that he's at. You know, he doesn't have to worry like other quarterbacks would about, you know, trying to get the ball into a seam. He knows his players are going to get open. He knows that there's going to be space. Yeah. Just put the ball where it has to be, and so far he's been doing that.
I really like this team a lot. The fact that they beat the Saints and only put up 16 points, this is where we're going to get into the defense now. Because yesterday they didn't have an offensive touchdown. They almost had a couple. Victor Cruz was down at the one-yard line. Odell dropped a touchdown. Odell really dropped two touchdowns. They almost put the ball in the end zone. They went for it on fourth down. But this defense, and you said the offense hasn't hit their stride. I don't think this defense has hit their stride either. Olivier Vernon got the biggest contract ever by a defensive player. And he hasn't been – he's been playing very well, but – I don't think he's playing up to that contract. I don't think he's been a stalwart defender. I do think that Jonathan Hankins and Damon Harrison are doing a great job. Janoris Jenkins is doing a great job. Eli Apple is doing a great job. Mm-hmm. Landon Collins had a couple of tackles for losses yesterday.
Two of them were in the first quarter.
One of them was a sack. This defense is playing great. They're playing great. And Drew Brees put on a textbook fourth quarter yesterday, but that's also because he's Drew Brees, and the Giants still have a question mark at linebacker. And Jonathan Casillas also, great game yesterday. But again, you said this offense hasn't hit their stride. Their defense hasn't hit their stride, and they're 2-0 for the first time since 2009. There are a lot of things to like.
No, I was actually wanting to talk about the defense more than the offense because it just shows yesterday when a team can put 52 points up on you, you know you made an absolute drastic change when that same quarterback came out with those same wide receivers and
same
those same
exact
backs.
Yeah. Same exact team.
Even a little bit better. Yeah. Benjamin Watson was their tight end last
Willie
year.
Willie Snead.
Now they have
Kobe Fleener.
Yeah.
They're a, yeah.
So you see them go from that to 13 points. You held Drew Brees to 3 points in the first half where he murdered you last year. Ryan, you said a very good point, though. Olivier Vernon has been good on the run, but we haven't seen him with a lot of pressure, but that comes with time. You've seen pressure from safeties, including Dominique Rodgers-Cromartie, Landon Collins, both getting sacks yesterday. This secondary gets a lot better. You see Janoris Jenkins, absolute stud, with just making that play until the whistle blows, knocking the ball out. Eli Apple, stone cold coverage. You saw it yesterday.
Yeah,
I would like him to have turned his head maybe a couple times because there were some iffy plays on Coleman where I think there could have been pass interference, but at the same time, he did a very good job keeping in stride. Guy has 4.4 speed. It's nasty. But like you said, just tweaking a couple of things. That's all they have to do, and they're going to have to do it when they're going to have to face, you know, the Vikings and the Packers coming up.
And they have a tough schedule too, and this is why this 2-0 start is really important, because now if they go 3-0, first of all, I don't remember the last time they started 3-0. Probably maybe 2008. The year after they won the Super Bowl, where they started 11-1, that's probably the last time the Giants went 3-0. The Redskins, they lost yesterday. They have not been playing well.
Bad loss. He hasn't been playing well, but we can.
Who, Kirk?
We can talk about that later.
Yeah, Kirk Cousins has not been playing well so far. But again, you start 3-0, 2-0 in the division, and then Your other game against Dallas is at home. You still have two to play against Philly, who they beat last week, the Browns.
They beat the Browns. We'll see what happens tonight against the Bears.
And then we'll see what happens tonight. Personally, I wanted the Redskins to win yesterday because Dallas still scares me more than Washington.
I would rather put Washington in a hole right now. Kick them out. Let them do their thing. They
just
go,
kick them out and put them at 0-3.
Kick them out, put them at 0-3.
Rather than have 3-0, 1-2, 1-2, 1-2.
Because if you think about what happened last year, Kirk Cousins made a run in the second half. We'll see what happens. But, you know,
no, that makes sense. One team out.
One team out, and then you already have that win over Dallas. So if you can beat both, then you can worry about Dallas when the time comes later. I think that would be
that's actually a very
optimal.
Good way, I was thinking of just how if the Redskins won, it's another loss for Dallas, and then when Romo comes back, you never know where Dallas can be. But no, I like that. Actually,
I was just thinking that you want everyone to be even, so you have even ground on everyone.
It forces Cousins to make the plays the second time around, and I don't think he's got that clutch bone in him, or that clutch gene, or whatever you want to call it.
Either way, we'll get into that game later because there's a lot that I want to talk about involving Odell Beckham and Josh Norman. We'll get into that later. But, again, 2-0 start. And we said that, again, everyone says the Giants can either go 10-6 or 6-10. I don't think that's a thing anymore. I think that what you're seeing from the Giants is the New York Giants. I don't think you're getting an inconsistent team anymore. I don't think we knew that they weren't getting the team from last year, but we had a feeling that there would be some inklings along the way where we had question marks about this team. I don't think there are any question marks anymore. I think the Giants, the only question mark is if Victor Cruz can stay healthy, if the O-line can stay consistent. That's pretty much it.
But again, you're talking about performance. You're not really talking about, you know, player gaps and people that, you know, you might have to swap in and out because there's no swapping needed. You have depth at each position.
Yeah.
I mean, really, except for quarterback, you know, knock on wood, but I'm not going to say anything of that nature. But
yeah, they haven't needed depth so far.
But like you said, Ryan, this isn't 6-10 or 10-6 football. It's at least 8-8, and I think it's going to stay at that if you want to talk about the foundation. You know, these next couple of years, if you can keep everyone healthy, you can keep everyone on this team, 8-8 football is what you can optimistically look at and expect from these Giants players.
Bright future ahead.
I think, yeah, like we're saying, I'm going to pull up the schedule right now, and I can guarantee you, before we even look at this, there are going to be games where we are going to change our minds from 3 weeks ago and today. There's going to be at least one or two games in here where we're not going to say, eh, I'm not so sure. I feel like there are going to be more games where we have a definitive answer. Home against the Skins, I'll give you my prediction on that later. At Minnesota,
I think that's
still a tough game, but...
Very tough game, but...
I think it became a lot easier.
I think it became a lot easier, and B, it's still a question mark, but I don't think the Giants or we as football fans are going to go into this game not expecting what the Giants are going to bring to the table.
Yeah, exactly. But like I said, the
same thing with the game against the Packers.
The tweaking needs to be there, though.
Right.
Because you saw what happened last night against the Packers. That Minnesota D, if you make a tiny mistake, they will capitalize on it. You saw Aaron Rodgers last night, too nonchalant in the pocket, his ball by his hip. He's not worried about who was around him. And that was just a tap from Linval Joseph, and that's the game.
Yep.
You know, Blaine Gabbert has had more fantasy points than Aaron Rodgers in the last 8 weeks.
No way.
Yep.
That's nuts. That's nuts.
He's on my waiver wire.
Yeah.
I'm not a big fan of Rodgers, by the way.
Really?
I'm not. I don't know. There's just something about him.
His play or just him?
Just him in general. And I think like his play lately has, like I said, been too nonchalant. He just shows me no emotion.
I'm telling you, it's his brother.
No, it's not.
It's his brother.
No, it's not. he knows he's the
better Rodgers.
The alpha Rodgers. But keep going.
But these two games at Minnesota, at Green Bay.
Yeah.
We don't have a definitive answer on what they will be, but we have... Again, we have an answer of what they're going to bring to the table, and it's a lot more optimism. These two aren't games where you're going to say they're either going to get killed or they're either going to kill. It's a game where we know it's going to be close now.
Definitely.
Last year against Minnesota, they got absolutely destroyed. But Giants also did not have Odell Beckham Jr. that game. Vikings also had Teddy Bridgewater that game. This game against Green Bay has not been playing well either. And the Giants have been playing very well. The Giants have let up 33 points. 33 points this year. No, 32, rather. And both of those are very good offenses.
Mm-hmm.
The Cowboys should be a very good offense, even with Dak Prescott. And the Saints...
Are the Saints.
Are the Saints. They are the offense.
No, they make their money on offense, straight up. But... You know, I think it comes down to next week. If you want to just look at next week, don't go forward. Look at next week against the Redskins. I think that has to be a win if you really want to solidify your spot right now as the alpha in the NFC East. You're 2-0 early, and then when you come back around, the only two teams I think, because I think that Carson Wentz is going to break once the season starts going on. I think those two teams are the only teams that are going to be able to beat you. If you can get two wins against both of them to start it off, you're in the driver's seat, mm-hmm. in my opinion. And you just go from there. Because after Minnesota and the Packers, Ryan, correct me if I'm wrong, you play the Eagles, the Rams. This isn't in any order. The Eagles, the Rams, and the Ravens, I think. Did I say that backwards?
You said it backwards.
Yeah, so it goes Ravens, Rams, Eagles.
It's Ravens at home. Rams in England, which counts as an away game.
Mm-hmm.
Eagles, bye week, then Eagles at home, Bengals at home, Bears at home. It's a three-game homestand. Those are unheard of in football. And then you're at Cleveland. That should be a win. At Steelers, we may have... Right now, I can't answer that question, nope. but we... Again, this is what is coming. Yeah. This is what's coming with the Giants now. We're getting more and more answers as the weeks go by, and it's only
you said
the
at
ending
Steelers?
Of week two. At Steelers.
Le'Veon Bell's back, too.
Le'Veon is back. But again, their run defense has been incredible.
But it's Le'Veon Bell.
It is Le'Veon
Who
Bell.
Who have they faced?
Ezekiel Elliott with the Cowboys O-line. They've
true.
Been playing
okay,
very
true.
Well.
Yeah, he hasn't looked that great either, though.
No, I'm not saying that they're going to halt Le'Veon to his tracks, but...
Right, then.
The Giants have a three-game homestand and a two-game home. They also have two... They have back-to-back road games three times this year.
But at that time, you're saying in week 13, that might be the time where, like we said...
We really know what the Giants are.
Maybe they hit the stride.
Your stride, right.
So, you never know.
Giants, Redskins, Thursday night. Who has the advantage? Odell Beckham Jr.
It's, or Josh it's Sunday. Norman? I'm sorry.
It's Thursday.
Thursday's Houston and.
You're right. You're right. New it's England. Sunday. It's Sunday.
Good one.
When's our Thursday game?
Because I'm going. That's why I was saying.
Do they have a Thursday game?
They should.
Packers.
I mean
the Eagle game. The Eagle game. Yeah. That's right. Is it? You're right.
I ruined your whole transition. I'm sorry.
It's okay.
I just had to say
it's okay. All right.
All right, bye.
I just wanted to make sure. Okay. Giants, Redskins. I don't know. I feel like the Giants, Redskins always play Thursday night. Giants, Redskins next Sunday during the day at 1 o'clock. Sorry. Who has the advantage? Odell Beckham Jr. or Josh Norman heading into next week? Find out right here on Visa East.
Hey, parents of children with asthma. Here's another hit from the Breathe Easies.
Don't smoke in the house. Don't smoke in the house. Don't smoke around the kids in the house. Don't smoke in the car. Don't smoke in the house. Don't break my heart.
Preventing asthma attacks can be as simple as making your home and car smoke-free zones. For more Breathe Easy tips to help stop asthma attacks, go to noattacks.org. Brought to you by the EPA and the Ad Council.
Hey, this is Flea from the Red Hot Chili Peppers for Rad. I'm here to remind you that drunk drivers are still a major killer of young adults in this country. So always choose a designated driver and remember, music lives, you should too.
Getting blown in the state of Mississippi. Papa was a copper and a mama was a hippie.
Public service message brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
J.R. Sean Kingston.
You're way too beautiful, girl. That's why it'll never work. You have me suicidal.
Beast of the East on WRPR 90.3 FM, Ramapo College Radio. What year did this song come out?
2007?
I think that's right.
Yeah, because it was sixth grade.
Yeah, sixth grade.
I'm pretty sure we were in sixth grade. Maybe it was 06. Beautiful Girls, Sean.
Maybe six.
Seven. It says seven.
Nice.
Good job, Scott.
This song samples Benny King's Stand By Me. I didn't know that.
Stand By Me. Yeah, it kind of goes with the beat.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. That song played at the wedding I was at on Saturday. I love that song.
How was Toronto? You never told us.
It was pretty sick.
Ryan's wearing a Maple Leaf shirt that's like the old school shirts. Well, I like those.
Old time hockey.
I like it a lot. It was fun though. It was fun. We had dinner 1,100 feet in the air. That was pretty cool. And the restaurant floor rotates.
I'd throw up. I told you I'd throw up already.
Well, it doesn't rotate.
No,
this
I know.
How was your dinner?
No. Ryan showed me where you know he was gonna eat, and I'm like, if I'm sitting next to the window, I'm going to throw up. And I look at his Snapchats, and I kind of got a little bit queasy because he was sitting next to the window just taking a picture. Then, right, I see his girlfriend Melissa's Snapchat, and they're laying down
on the glass floor.
I shut it off. I literally just shut my phone off.
That's what we...
So when you go on the glass floor, they have this big sign that says how much weight it can hold. It's like, oh, this thing can hold 3.5 orcas. This thing can hold 35 moose. It can hold 3,500 raccoons. I'm like, how many human beings does it hold? I don't care if it can hold the globe. I just want to know how many humans it holds. So we're on the glass floor. And first of all, there's one panel. It's only like 16 panels. I guess if it was glass all the way around, it would be physically impossible to stand. I don't know. But there's one panel where you can look straight. Melissa just texted me with a laughing emoji. There's one panel. If you look straight down to the panel, you can see Rogers Center. And I said, imagine if the roof was closed, obviously, because they weren't playing. But imagine being up there and seeing the roof open.
And just watching a game from there. Yeah.
That'd be sick.
Watch a game from there.
Well, obviously not, but still, that'd be
right,
no. That's definitely a cool experience. You know, I would probably do it because
have you ever seen the edge walk? Melissa wanted to do the edge walk. You get tied to a cable on the antenna, and you can lean over the city. I was like, Melissa, there's no.
If people want projectile vomit on them from 1,100 feet up, sure, I'll do it for you.
I would get my blood going, man. I might.
I'm not a thrill seeker. I don't do stuff like that. There's this fine line between my thrills and other people's.
I haven't been to Six Flags Great Adventure since Fright Fest 2013.
I think that compares to what you're talking
about. Yeah, I know.
But like that's like no roller coasters. Roller coasters are cake for me. But you talk about leaning over a city. No, I'll take a hard pass.
Yeah, that is one thing.
Where did that comment?
It's kind of cool though.
No, because you were just saying like thrills. I was like, oh yeah, I remember when
I haven't been to Six Flags.
It's been a long time.
It definitely looked like a cool experience.
Toronto was fun.
You get to go to Hockey Hall of Fame?
Yes.
Yeah,
oh,
I
didn't show you this picture. Hold on.
So you're shooting against Lundqvist.
Oh, yeah. So
did you score?
I went 1-for-8.
All right.
Lundqvist is pretty good, man. Well, he's not bad.
Yeah, some say he's pretty good.
So yeah, they have like the whole virtual reality thing. Awesome. And the lady was like, oh, do you want to go against Carey Price, Toronto's goalie? Who's Toronto's goalie?
Ben Bishop.
No, that's Tampa. That's Tampa. I don't remember. She was like, do you want to go against Price, the other guy, or Lundqvist? I'm wearing my devil jersey. I'm like, who do you think I want to go up against? I told her Henrik. So let me pull up the picture from yesterday.
That's awesome.
Who's Toronto?
I got to kiss the Stanley Cup.
Is it the actual one?
That's the actual one.
You just let people kiss it?
I asked the guy. I was like, I'm not allowed to kiss it, am I? He was like, no, you can. I started making out with the thing. Are you kidding me?
I'd be like, who else? I would ask him who else kissed us today. I'm like, nah, I'm good. I'm good with the picture.
We gotta add that sound effect to the board.
Nah, that's disgusting.
That is pretty gross. Let's not do that.
And again, I can't hear it anyway.
Let's not do that. All right. Back to the Giants. Unless if there's anything else I want to talk about.
No, let's go.
We'll listen to it later.
Wait, one more thing. There's they have a TSN broadcast center, so you can like call plays and stuff. I gotta show you. It's pretty cool. So anyway, going back to the Giants. Next Sunday, not Thursday, Giants, Redskins, Odell, Josh Norman. We all know what happened.
I'm too. Ding, ding, ding.
Ding, ding, ding is right. We all know what happened last year.
Yep.
And if you want my honest opinion on who has the advantage, I think it's Josh Norman all the way, and here's why. Here's why. You don't look happy.
No, go ahead.
Josh Norman and Odell Beckham Jr. have not changed who they are since last year. Yesterday, I was watching highlights of the Cowboys and Redskins game, and Josh Norman going up against Des Bryant, all talk, all chirping. I don't remember if he had a good game or not, but Norman has been like that since day one. All talk, and he's a genius. He knows how to get into guys' heads. Odell Beckham Jr. yesterday showed some mini flashbacks of what he has done in the past against Josh Norman, against what he did against the Bills. He just showed flashbacks of his prima donna play. Did you not see that stiff arm, aka smack to the head, against Sterling Moore yesterday when he was running out of bounds?
Yep.
No, I didn't.
You didn't see that?
No.
He was running along the left side.
It was like a multiple times of like when they go to the commercial and they do like the slow-mo plays. Like that was like, that
he
was great, like
took
three
his
times.
Arm and literally just plowed his palm into his temple. And I'm watching the game and keep him. I'm watching the game. I was watching it at 12:30 a.m. last night because I didn't want anyone telling me about the Giant game, so I had it recorded because I was up north. And I'm watching the game, and I'm like, "What? I'm like, what is he doing?" And Melissa wakes up. She was like, "Can you shut up?" I'm like, "Sorry," but like, I just got so annoyed. Like, he's still the easiest person to let someone in his head. And even before that, Sterling Moore played very physical yesterday, all clean, all great defense. And Sterling Moore had a great play on that fourth down against Odell, a great deflection, and. I guess there was one play where Moore tackled him pretty hard after a first down. And Odell spiked the ball like, out of spite, out of anger, whatever. And he did that a couple of times. And I was like, all right, he's getting a little annoyed. And I get it. No one loves being hit hard. I understand that. But he still is taking it to another level. And I saw it with that stiff arm yesterday. It wasn't a stiff arm like this. He smacked him across the head.
What you're basically, what he did last year against Norman.
Yeah, but I mean, he didn't reach that level, and if he reaches that level on Sunday,
but that's what started everything. They started slapping each other
right,
in the head.
Right.
Doesn't that hurt your hand? That's a helmet.
because football players are the dumbest athletes. They're the dumbest athletes out there.
12 prior yesterday.
What did he do?
Cost the team the game.
What did he do?
Slant across. Pass interference was called on his defender. He caught the ball, was in bounds, went out of bounds, but they were like pushing and shoving each other the whole way until he caught the ball. As he went out of bounds, two refs standing right there, he looks at the player and throws the ball at him. Penalties offset, and they eventually lose the game.
Yeah, football player.
Got him on the 5-yard line. Got the Browns on the 5-yard line with 21 seconds left.
Terrence Williams last week against the Giants. Five seconds left, cuts inside. They are the dumbest. Every time someone gets a concussion, all you do, feel better. They tell them on the, that's going to make the guy feel better.
That's the mentality.
Whenever they get to a fight, they punch each other. And they're like, don't you, helmet, mask. Like,
no. This game is straight adrenaline.
Idiot.
No, but this is the thing.
Idiots.
No, I know. But you want to talk about.
That's why I love Russell Wilson. He's the one that told me he listens to gospel music before games. I was like, you know, I'm going to start doing that. Maybe I won't get too hyped up.
No, he needs to get hyped up or something. No, he needs to get hyped up or something now.
That's true.
But going back to, you know, Beckham and Norman, I think this year is going to be completely different. Ben McAdoo supposedly has already talked to him about it.
I would hope.
Not about that in general, his character.
Yeah.
He needs to realize that he is a target now. And unfortunately, he's been a target since he's been a rookie. You know, so he hasn't been able to ease himself into it. It went from 0 to 100. I'm not going to say... I'll say real quick.
Real quick.
nice
job.
No, but it did. It went from 0 to 100, and he didn't know how to deal with it. And that's where I saw it all explode last year.
Yeah.
This year, I think, can't speak for him or for anyone else on that team that's seen it, he's going to take it down a notch. Obviously, with Sterling Moore, he did get a little bit heated, but this is different. He understands what happened last year. He understands there's going to be binoculars and microscopes on everything he does during this game.
But there's binoculars on every game he plays.
This is absolutely different.
I know it's different.
There are literally going to be a couple of refs that be like, listen, we'll take this. Make sure you're paying attention to them, too.
Yeah.
Let Norman get in trouble. Do your thing. Do what you know you can do. Physically, he is better than him.
Yeah, he is.
Physically, he's better than him. Look at what he did. Again,
Odell burned Norman on so many routes last year.
Why do you think Norman didn't want to play Antonio Brown? He physically, I think, cannot match up with top receivers.
Because he's not that good.
Exactly.
He's not that good.
So understand that. Realize that. Put that in the back of your mind.
Yes.
I think that's what he has to do, and that's what he's going to do.
I know. I hope he does that, because everything you're saying is right. He needs to do that. But Odell is the type of person where he's better than everyone, but he always has to do something extracurricular. Why? He knows he's one of the most hated people in the league, but I feel like he doesn't realize why. Like, he has the mentality... I shouldn't say that. He knows that people don't like him, but he doesn't know why people don't like him. It's because of things like that. He's been in this situation before. He got called the prima donna 9 weeks before the whole Norman incident. That game against Buffalo where he got fined for punching players in the face, and he got interviewed on the Michael K show, and he said, I don't know what a prima donna is, and Michael K and Don LaGreca hung up on him. They hung up on him. Because that's how he is. He doesn't like to be touched. He doesn't like to be touched. And when he does, he goes insane. And you know what the first thing Josh Norman is going to say to him next week? I'm back. Whether Josh Norman beats him or not, Josh Norman is going to say, I'm back. What are you going to do about it? And who knows? Again, we can all agree, and I think everyone on this planet should agree, hopefully, that Odell should burn Josh Norman and can burn Josh Norman on every single route that he runs. In this game, in the Giants and Panthers game last year, later on this year, every game for the next 5 years that Josh Norman is on the Washington Redskins.
Yep. But now, can I tell you how you can make this just eradicate itself? How you don't let this escalate or even get to that point?
If you're the Giants, please.
Feed him. Feed him early. Make sure he gets the catches. Make sure he puts a statement. Josh Norman's going to walk up and say, yeah, I'm back. What are you going to do about it? He's going to catch 3-4 catches for 50-plus yards in the first quarter and say, there you go.
But is that smart to make it a personal battle if you're
don't make
Giants?
It a personal... It's not making it a personal battle.
Is it? It's not?
Well, it's shutting him up by playing.
But that's making it a personal battle. I get what you're saying, but yeah. But it is.
Just look to him, is what I'm trying to say.
Well, they always do. He's number one.
Rivalries. but I'm just saying. Rivalries bring out the best in people. And
do they?
Yes. Yes. this was new. This sparked. This.
Okay, you're right.
You can't call it a rivalry last year because it didn't happen to you.
Okay, you're right.
This is a rivalry between them two now, whether they like it or not. And I think they do like it. But I think that Odell
Norman likes it. Norman
loves it.
Norman hasn't shut up about it.
He got his contract. But I could talk about that for days. Anyway, yeah. Odell Beckham Jr. on Sunday will be collected for his, you know, demeanor, for his ego, will be a lot more collected than last year. I don't think it's going to escalate to anything, and I think he's just going to beat him because I know he can, and he knows he can.
You know what I
hope he does.
Yeah, yeah, right. you know what I think is going to play a big part, though? Ben McAdoo. Tom Coughlin and the Giants. But I think Ben McAdoo is, now that he's a new coach and he wants to make a statement, this is the statement he has to make if he hasn't done so already. He needs to keep Odell calm, cool, and collected. Because last year and the year before that, Tom Coughlin was scared of Odell Beckham Jr. He was scared of how good he was because Odell Beckham Jr. is, with him and Eli, they are the two most talented players on this football team. And they were scared of that. And who did they put to return punts when Dwayne Harris got hurt in the Carolina game last year? They put Odell Beckham Jr. back there.
Whose idea was that?
I would think it was Coughlin's.
No, it is. But like you said, McAdoo brings an entire different demeanor.
Yeah.
I mean, last year he really couldn't say. I mean, he was the offensive coordinator. You know, afterward.
But he only had so much.
He only had so much to say. And last year, what did Tom Coughlin do? He didn't go up to Norman to Odell himself and say, "Listen, you need to calm down."
He had
during
the
that
wide
whole thing.
Receivers coach.
Exactly. If anything even comes close to what happened last year,
Ben McAdoo is going to say, Odell, come on.
Not even
the field.
Snap, he's going to rip his jersey over. Yeah. Because McAdoo already said he's talked to his team, not just Odell Beckham, his team, about character, about composing yourself and making sure that you are in the right state of mind for every single game. That's what you've seen these first two games with this team. Coming to this game is obviously going to be a giant cloud looming over this team to see what Odell does. And if he's a leader of this team, if he's going to lead this team the way he should be, he has to be calm and collected at that line.
And I've said it a million times. Tom Coughlin was probably getting fired or whatever you want to call it last year, no matter what happened, especially if the Giants were missing the playoffs. If the Giants missed the playoffs last year, whether the thing happened with Odell or not, that was Tom Coughlin's last year. But that game really did the job. The fact that Tom Coughlin had no discipline plan for Odell Beckham Jr. whatsoever, and his only plan was to have the wide receivers coach, some little scrawny guy, go up to him and say, calm down, Odell. That's not being – and that's a big reason, in my opinion, why Coughlin was let go last year, because he was scared of Odell and he had no discipline. And he put the most hated guy on that football field and arguably in football in general on the punt return team. And I get it. As Odell is the best option that the Giants have. But in that game, was he the best option that they had?
No.
That was just silly. That's silly to put him out there. Because
the most hated guy.
Even if it's a fair catch.
The most hated.
There's nothing stopping someone just
bulldozing him.
Bulldozing him.
And
put nobody out there. This is your job.
And it's the second most dangerous play in football.
Yeah.
Behind kickoffs.
Which is essentially the same thing.
Do you know what I think is a lot better this year as well? Like, obviously, you know, Odell's mindset is up in the air. We can't see what happens until it does happen. But I think it also helps that you have Victor Cruz back, who is basically the leader of this wide receiving core.
The veteran,
he has the veteran mentality. And you have Sterling Shepard, too, and they've already hit it off, these two. Obviously, you know, spreading the sugar, you've seen how these guys, after first downs, they run up to each other, knock each other on the head. There's camaraderie now. Last year, I feel like Odell was kind of in his own bubble. Because
he had Reuben Randall.
Because he had to do everything.
Yeah, no, you're right.
He was the only option. He was clawing for someone. He was crying out for someone to help him. So he didn't have to get hit all the time. So he didn't have to be the guy that everyone looked at. Now he's not the only guy to look at. And I think that helps.
I just don't want it to be a personal battle. Play physical. Norman's going to do that. First play, Norman is going to jam him. That's what's going to happen.
First play, Odell's going deep.
Do you think you think Norman's going to follow him?
No.
He hasn't.
Do
followed,
I think Norman is going to follow him? That's a good question. I'm going to go with no.
Does anyone know what Norman did on Dez yesterday?
No.
That's it. But I know when Antonio Brown.
All I know is that week
it was
one,
like three or two targets, maybe I think with them
week
when he was
one,
covering him. But then again, he didn't let up anything.
Week one, Josh Norman lined up on, was it the left side? I think it was the left side. 92% of the plays week one. I don't know what he did yesterday.
Yeah,
but last year with Carolina, it was 52-48 left side.
Yeah,
that's just the so that's a decision by the Redskins.
Mm-hmm. Oh, no, I know.
That's a separate decision, but right.
I want to see, is he going to follow him? But going back to the advantage thing, if you asked me before even week one who has the advantage, I would say Odell Beckham, just because pure talent-wise. I think Ben McAdoo is a huge factor in it, taking control of him, I think, really restructuring his character, even though he has, like you said, flaws yesterday. But Josh Norman's been playing good these past 2 weeks.
Yeah.
And I actually kind of give it to Norman because his job is to get you in his head, and he works. He does very good at it. He doesn't stop talking, which is annoying, you know, obviously. And you just don't know. It's a big question.
I'm excited.
Odell's going to react.
I'm honestly excited because, A, you got to see it in person last year.
I did.
Now, I'm going.
You're going to see it in person.
Ugh. No one's going to even be watching the game. At least at
I
first.
Did not I didn't watch the game.
The entire first quarter, everyone is going to be watching them on the outside.
I know.
Including me. Oh, Sterling Shepard caught a 70-yard touchdown. I don't care.
Yeah.
at least in the first quarter, I don't care. No, it's
yeah, but you see what Odell
the first quarter obviously is going to set the foundation for what we're going to see, and hopefully Odell can keep
I hope they,
his
I hope
mouth
they do what
shut.
You said. First play, set him up on whatever side he is.
Not set him up on any side. Just burn him.
And what if he drops the ball
again?
Oh well. What if he drops the ball?
That's on him.
Cause he dropped it yesterday.
He dropped it yesterday
on a perfect pass.
Ryan, it won't happen again.
It won't happen. He dropped it yesterday.
Yeah, but
you gotta expect him to make the catch.
Yeah.
Until he doesn't. Again, if there's anyone, I'm throwing the ball.
I trust Odell. Don't
Odell
worry,
catches
I
that ball 99 out of 100 times.
Yes,
98 out of 100 times.
He's gonna turn around and drop Josh Norman in the face.
If he drops the ball, if they go deep to him first play and he drops the ball.
Yo, to be honest, if that did happen, if I was Ben McAdoo, I'd literally pull him off right away and just like let him calm down because you know he's
yes.
gonna be mad.
Yes,
you would
yes.
not. Don't let him yes. back on the field. You take him off. You go, listen to me. You listen to me right now. It's one play. It's the first play. You do not get crazy.
Like, because because you know if he catches, if he drops that ball, if they go to him first play and he drops that ball, oh, you know Norman. You know Norman's gonna go off.
Oh yeah, get out, get over
he's
here.
He's gonna go off. So Ben McAdoo should say, calm down. And you know what? And you know what? Let's say McAdoo does that. You know what Norman's going to say? Because
you went to daddy?
Yeah. He's going to say something like, oh, well, why'd you go off the field, you little you-know-what? But Odell has to realize how predictable guys like that are.
Yes.
Which is why you can't let it get to your head.
You play your best and let karma do its work.
Yeah.
Don't go off movies, but you see that always those guys in movies, at the end of the day, what happens? They're the one tripping over their own feet or making the bad play. Just play your game. You're physically better than him. Yeah. Mentally? Not sure. That's yeah. where
mentally.
That's where
that
that's,
might be a big factor.
That's where Odell has to make his
one of the greats. Because you see guys like Randy Moss like never really. He was obviously a big flashy guy, but he was like, all right, if you want to keep talking, I'm going to beat you. I'm going to beat you all day.
This is what I'm getting to. You so want to talk about Odell being one of the greats.
That's a big factor. I mean, I know we're saying, what 3 years, three seasons?
Have you ever seen Antonio Brown get in a fight?
No.
Have you ever seen Julio Jones get in a fight?
No. Odell.
You think Julio Jones would be
yeah, right?
furious.
Antonio got fined, and he said that's nothing to a boss. Like, the guy's
a boss, though.
But this conversation, it all goes back to what I said 20 minutes ago. This conversation does not happen without yesterday. This conversation does not happen right now if Odell Beckham Jr. does not show highlights of his mistakes yesterday. It doesn't happen. And that's what scares me because I just feel – because you watch Norman and you know he has not changed. He hasn't kept Odell's name out of his mouth since December 20th, 2015. Every magazine article it has his name in it, Norman and Odell.
Pretty sure the contract he signed probably has like a word
must
for
Odell. Must sign, yeah.
Yeah.
Must talk about Odell in every press. Like, and yesterday he did not stop talking about Dez Bryant. And Dez turned away every time. He turned away every time because Dez is mentally smart. You know what Odell's going to do? Touche. But on the football field, that is. But can Odell do that? If yesterday did not happen, maybe I'm sitting here saying to myself, okay, maybe he's changed.
Realistically, words are definitely going to come out. Odell gets a first down, he's turning around and talking. It's the physical aspects is what...
If I'm Odell, I know it's difficult because now rivalry. And right now, it's probably the biggest rivalry one-on-one we've seen in football in...
Oh, wow.
A long time, and we saw what happened with Perfect last year in the Steelers and Antonio Brown. I think this beats that by far.
No doubt.
This is the best one-on-one rivalry we have seen in football in a long time. And I get it. It's very difficult for you to stay calm against the guy that you hate in this league the absolute most. I get it's difficult because the first thing you want to do is shut them up right away and go right into their face and be like, yeah. You know what? Like,
there's nothing wrong with trash talking.
Screw you.
And that's what you're definitely going to find. Like I said, if Norman bats a ball down, he's going to say something.
And there's nothing wrong with trash talking, but...
When you make it physical, when you start making it personal, that is when it gets too far. Look at Andre Johnson and Courtland Finnegan.
Oh, good one.
That's talking trash, getting physical. Didn't have to get physical at all, and it absolutely did. Last year, obviously, was the epitome of that. But I don't think you're going to see it this year. I really don't. Again, if Odell Beckham's smart, I know he's going to get a first down or a touchdown. He's going to turn around and he's going to talk.
Yeah.
But if he's smart, hopefully you can do what Dez Bryant did. You can take some notes and just turn around.
Two things. You touched on it before. The refs are going to know. The Roger Goodell in the NFL talked to the refs from yesterday's Steelers and Bengals game and said, look, if anything gets out of hand or if it has potential, you better step in real quick. They're going to do that this week because the refs, terrible in that game. None of that stuff should have happened anyway, but no flags were thrown for the first quarter and a half between them two.
Yeah,
and there could have been four personal Odell got called for three personal fouls in the third quarter, where he really could have gotten called for 10 throughout the game. And now Odell has a rule named after him. Not named after him, but...
I was like, what?
He has a rule...
Basically in place for him, the unsportsmanlike conduct. Yeah,
yeah. If you get two, what is it, unsportsmanlike conduct,
you're done.
That is going to help, too, because these refs are going to say... Well, someone's going to go up to these refs and say, you better be careful. You better watch them.
Speaking
and you
of...
Know what, and you know what? I think Odell knows that rule, too. Odell knows that he has a rule because of him and because of his actions. Two of those, and he's gone.
Yeah. But again, speaking of, officiating, by the way, Ryan, you said you watched yesterday's game, like, religiously. How bad was that officiating?
Yesterday's Giant game?
Awful. Absolutely awful.
It was pretty bad. It was pretty bad.
But this is what I'm saying. They better...
I watched the game running on 6 hours of sleep.
No, I know. But this is
I
what...
I wasn't paying attention.
There's no dots.
Yeah.
You talk about Victor Cruz's play in the end zone. Eli Manning's quote-unquote fumble when it was blatantly in his hand and his knee was on the ground. It's stuff like that. We've seen the officiating from... The Jacksonville and Green Bay game. Supposedly there were 19 calls missed, and it would have changed the game, one of them being a pass interference that would have put the Jaguars in the red zone. The officiating has been bad to start off, and I don't need... I definitely don't need... My heart doesn't need it. My dad's heart doesn't need it next week.
My heart?
You don't need... You know, Odell Beckham and Josh
he
Norman.
Broke my heart.
You don't need these two running out. There's obviously going to be pushing and shoving, but calls better be made.
They will be.
Instead of, you can't treat it like, you know, these two are obviously going to be push and shove each other. No, calls need to be made, and the officiating needs to get a lot better than what I've seen these first 2 weeks. Not just with the Giants, but league-wide, it's been pretty bad, supposedly.
There are a lot of factors that are going to play into this, and you touched on it before also. The fact that Sterling Shepard and Victor Cruz are there. Odell Beckham Jr. was the big brother last year. Victor Cruz,
this year,
despite not playing in almost 2 years and only being back for 2 weeks, is still the big brother. And now, Odell Beckham Jr. has a great relationship with the second, or if you want to put it third, in Sterling Shepard. I would go Odell, Shepard, Cruz. That's just me, but...
You know what?
I don't really think it matters.
This is what I say when you want to talk about the chemistry of them. They're actually triplets, where Cruz was born first and Shepard was born last. Honestly, is what it came down to, because they are even. You can't separate them as big brother, middle brother, and little brother. They're triplets. They can do the same things as each other. They have the same characteristics. It's all about bringing that together and having that camaraderie. And he's definitely going to need that, Odell, on Sunday, without a doubt. They're obviously going to go to him if something escalates. And I think you're going to see Cruz run over first.
Oh, I agree.
Without a doubt.
I agree. And people were... this goes back to Coughlin. The Giants in general were scared of Odell. You think Odell Beckham Jr. is going to listen to Ruben Randle or Dwayne Harris telling him to calm down?
I was looking for Eli to do something, but then again...
Eli's not a...
He kind of just stands there. Oh, man.
Yeah, he's not...
I put a lot of blame on Eli last year, too, about that.
He's saying he should be.
Like, he should be, but he's not. He's a leader in a different way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There are times where I see him get angry if someone, like, runs the wrong route or something like that, and you look at him like, oh, whoa, look at Eli. And he's not that type of person, but in that kind of situation, he should be. And you know what? The little brother last year, and this was Ruben Randle or whoever, the little brother was scared to go up to Odell Beckham Jr. The little brother now in Sterling Shepard, I don't think he'll be afraid to go up to him.
Nope.
And you know Victor Cruz won't be
not at all
afraid either.
Not at all.
Because Victor Cruz, despite only playing 4 games in his career, he's a 7-year vet. Come on, that was a good
Come
one.
Come on, don't give that to him. I'll give that
but,
to him.
But in all seriousness, though, this chemistry with this team is very good. Their offensive chemistry is great. Their defensive chemistry is great. The chemistry on the sidelines now with some new coaching staff and now Ben McAdoo at the helm, it's great. You know what? Odell Beckham Jr. still has some mentality issues. He might get very angry 5 seconds into the game. That's a very good possibility. But the Giants need to do their job. And you know what? Odell Beckham Jr., even though he has not been the most valuable player on this team the last couple of weeks, he hasn't even been the most valuable receiver on this team in the last couple of weeks, the Giants still